In this video, we will learn a relatively simple node setup to break the visible repetition in seamless textures directly in Blender. The good thing is, you don't need to be a node expert nor a mathematician in order to follow along, but a little bit of shader node work knowledge is required. This video here is actually a free preview from my recently updated Blender Launchpad course. I added over 60 new video lessons to the existing 200 videos covering UV mapping, texturing, texture painting, and texture baking. So if this video here is a bit too advanced for you, in the course we will go over everything about texturing in Blender from scratch. If you want to learn more, check academy.ctboost.com, link down below in the video description. Also, I added some additional links down below in the video description to other tutorials tackling this subject here a bit differently, like the awesome tutorial by Arendale, so check it out down below in the video description. Before we get started, you can sign up to our free Blender resource section at ctboost.com/resources to get access to our free Blender beginners course and our regularly updated Blender shortcut PDF. Link down below in the video description and an email is required. And now have fun with this video. One little note, I have the Node Wrangler add-on enabled that is shipped with Blender and can be activated in the preferences, which adds some useful keyboard commands for working with the shader nodes in Blender, which I will use in this video here. So here I added this seamless ground texture from ccz-woodtextures.com using the object texture coordinates, the mapping node I set to texture and scaled this up to 10. And here I used the box mapping with 0.2 blend. So this is all great. However, when it comes to tileable textures, the biggest downside is that you can see the repeating patterns. On some textures it's stronger, on some textures it's weaker. However, when you are further away and cover a large area with the texture, you can always see this repeating pattern somewhere. And this certainly looks unnatural. So how can we break this repeating pattern in a nice way? By still using the benefits of a tileable texture that we can't see any seams between all the tiles. For this, I will now show you a very nice node setup, which however is not my invention. I discovered this node setup here on Reddit from the user u/hixas, sorry if I mispronounce your name. And he shared this very nice node setup here on Reddit, which I will use as foundation for this video here. So all credits to him. I don't know if he invented this, but here I saw it the first time. You can find the link to the original post in the video description below. So the basic principle is relatively easy. First of all, let's hit Shift A, go to texture and add a Voronoi texture. Let's select this and press Ctrl T to add this mapping and texture coordinate node. Since we only want to scale the Voronoi texture, we can Ctrl X, remove the mapping node and change the texture coordinates to object. Now let's hit Ctrl Shift left click on this node 2 times to preview the color output. With the Voronoi texture, as you know, we have all these colorful tiles. Let's set the scale down to 0.5 to have these very large tiles. And if I plug in a converter color ramp in between here, we can change this to a grayscale texture. We can use grayscale images as masks or as input for numeric values, meaning everything black on the texture will be 0, everything white on the texture will be 1, and all the grayscale values will be some values in between. So this we cannot only use for the principal shader, this we can basically use anywhere else where we can change numeric values. So you can see all these cells here have different colors. That means the numeric value on each cell is different. So, and now comes the magic. Here we have the mapping node, which controls the position of the tileable texture. And if we now plug the color ramp into the location, for example, let's Ctrl Shift left click on the principal node to see what's going on. We are now changing the location of this texture over here on each cell. Since each cell has a different brightness, we are changing the position on each cell using this Voronoi texture. You can see when I change this color ramp how each cell is moving the texture a bit differently. And the same we can even use for rotation. So we can randomize the rotation for each cell. How to avoid this stretching I will cover later in this video. And we can even use this for randomizing the scale, which is quite interesting. So however, for now, Let's only change the location. And also, let's do not use the color ramp. You can see when I move this too far, some of those cells just stand still, which I don't want. So let's Control X, remove the color ramp, and hit Shift A and add a math node here in between. So I'm not a mathematician, or should I say math magician, because all this math stuff is pure magic to me. However, when we Control Shift left click on this math node here, we can see what this does. This also turns the Voronoi texture into black and white, but this time it's not limited to 0 and 1. We can basically change the values over here. And if we take a look over here, no matter how much I change this, it will always move the texture. So, but now you can see with add enabled up here, it's basically moving the same on all different cells. But I want to have a bit more variation. So let's change this to multiply. Now, if I change the value over here, you can see that all these cells are moving differently and I can go to infinity and it's always moving, which is pretty nice. Then let's duplicate this and use the same settings here for the rotation. So, and I showed you when I rotate this, it's now randomizing the rotation for all three axes over here. When we're using the object texture coordinates and rotating one axis, the other two axes will be stretched in some weird angles, which I don't know exactly why it happens, but it does happen. So we have to deal with this. However, when we are just adding this texture onto a flat surface and want to randomize the rotation here a bit, we can restrict the rotation to the z-axis only, and then we don't get any stretching. For that, let's hit Shift A, go to Converter and add a combine XYZ behind here and change this to the Z axis. And now we are only changing the Z rotation here. That means if I change this one here, you can see we don't get any stretching, but we are rotating everything. However, you can see if you use crazy high numbers, everything is weirdly rotated. So I would only use very low values here unless it looks awesome if you use higher values. So maybe go with 0.5 for now, which adds a little bit of rotation here. And for the location, you can use whatever you want here. Let's just use 10. So this looks all great already, as you can see from afar. However, if we are zooming in here, we still have all these bad seams, which is certainly the one thing we don't want it because we are using seamless textures here. So how can we deal with that? Well, there is also a solution I have from this Reddit post, which is so awesome. Let's select all these nodes here, the mapping nodes, texture coordinates, and all these texture nodes, including the principal shader, and Shift D it up here. So if I Control Shift left click in here, here we have the whole texture setup, but without any random rotation or location change. So here the seamless part from the seamless texture is still working. And now we want to use this nice texture as mask to blend over these seams. For that, we need another Voronoi texture with the same settings here, except this distance metric. So we can't use the exact same texture. We need to duplicate this. So let's hit Shift D, put it up here. And now I want to mix these two principal shaders. Here again, we can use a Node Wrangler add-on. Hold down Control Shift, right click on one of those principal shaders, then drag this to the other one and release all your buttons. And then these two will be mixed using the mix shader. So before we go into this, let's have a look at this second Voronoi texture. Let's Control Shift left click on here and let's change the feature output to distance to edge. Now let's go to the distance input once again, because the other outputs disappear, as you can see. And now we have this weird looking shape. However, we also need a color ramp in between here, because now, see the magic, if I move this to the side, we now have this black lines, which lie exactly on the position of all the seams, plus a little bit transition onto both sides. And you know what we can do with black and white images? We can use these as mask. So let's use this as fec import for this mix shader down here, which mixes the default setup of our seamless texture with our crazy rotated and moved texture setup down here. So let's reconnect this to the surface. And now to better understand what's going on here, let's add a simple hue saturation node just temporarily. I will delete it later on. Just change the color here a bit. So this black and white texture on the black areas, The default setup will be displayed without any visible seams because it's using input 1. Black means 0. The fact value set to 0 would use the first input only. And on all the white areas, we will see this crazy setup here. And everywhere where we have this seam, we have this nice overblending of this default setup where we don't have any seams. So with the colored version, you can see it pretty clearly. If I move anything over here, it's only moving the texture in the seam area. And if I rotate something down here, for example, or change the location, it's only changing inside all these tiles. Isn't this an awesome setup? So that means if I remove this use saturation value node and zoom back a little bit, we have like a perfect setup with a tileable texture randomized without seeing any visible seams here. How awesome is that? Certainly you can play around with how big this transition should be. You can see if I make this very sharp, we can again nearly see all the seams. If I make it brighter, we have a larger area which will be blended over. So, and then you can play around with the rotation and with the location change to have exactly what you want. Important, when you want to change the scaling of the Voronoi texture, so the scaling of the cells, you have to use the exact same values for both Voronoi textures. So you have to change both manually, or if you want to do it smart, you hit Shift A, add a value node, which is basically just a numeric value, plug this into the two scale values of the Voronoi textures, also the one down here. And now we can change the value over here, and it will change the size of the cells for both Voronoi textures. Pretty awesome. Also, when I add a UV sphere here and simply drag and drop this material onto the sphere, we can see that we get some weird stretching in some areas. Let's increase the rotation here a bit crazy. Here, for example, it gets weirdly stretched. And that's because right now we are rotating this on the Z-axis, but no matter on what axis I rotate this, it will lead to stretching on the other two axes. When we are using this on the flat surface, we can't notice this because we don't have a X or Y rotation here. We only see the Z-axis from top here, but on an object with volume, we can see also the texture projection from the X and the Y axis. So we see this stretching. In this case, if you use an object with volume, I would remove this rotation randomization completely. So we are only changing the location on all these different cells, which in most cases is already enough to break the tiling quite a bit. And then you can see it works perfectly fine. So again, I have to thank this guy on Reddit. This is such an awesome setup to break the tiling of your textures. Certainly, as addition to this setup, you can also mix in other textures. You can change the color variation of all the textures a bit to add more variation overall, so you don't use the same color here. So in this video, I wanted to show you how to change the location and rotation of the texture randomly, but certainly you can do even more with color and so on and so forth. Yeah. And now just drag and drop it everywhere. And it looks awesome. Look at this muddy fences. Sweet. After testing this method a bit, I realized it works pretty well, but there's one additional setting which I want to add here to this video, which helps us to randomize this even more. So right now, when we take a look down here, with this value we change the location. When we change this, you can see that although with different speed, the texture in each cell is changing only in one direction. So, and I found a quick way to also randomize this a little bit into the other directions. So what we do, let's hit Shift A, go to Converter and click on Separate XYZ, plug it behind here, hit Shift A once again and click on Combine XYZ, plug it in here and then simply combine X, Y, and Z. So now, before we sending this information over to the location, we separated all the axes. So now we have access to these axes. You know what I mean? And in here, we can change each axis. So let's hit Shift A, go to Converter, add a mask node, change this to multiply. So we have the same setting as over here. Plug this in here, duplicate this with Shift D and plug this into each of those. And this is a very simple setup. There might be a better solution to automatically randomize this, but this works pretty well and quickly. So if I now change any value here, you can see now it's only changing the X direction. Here it's changing the Y direction. And here, which you mainly can see on the sphere, it's changing the Z direction. So now basically enter a few different values in these three. And now if we change stuff over here, everything is already a bit randomized. And with this value, we can randomize this even more. So, and in this way, it works even better because when I was using other textures, in some cases, I could see the pattern still somehow. Depends on how many noticeable features you have on the texture. But this helped a lot to break this even more, especially when we can't use the rotate randomization on surfaces with volume. But if you have a flat surface, the randomization of the rotation helps certainly a lot to break the tiling. Thanks a lot for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed this free tutorial from the Blender Launchpad course update. If you want to learn more about the course and the UV mapping and texturing update, check academy.ctboost.com. Also, if texturing in Blender is too limited for you, maybe Substance Painter might be the right solution. We also have a full introduction course on that as well, link down below in the video description. That's it for this video, guys. Like and subscribe and ring the bell below if you like, and I will see you guys in one of the next videos. Goodbye.